This was the result. This was the victory. The payoff for the price that was paid. Jubilation on VE Day. Victory in Europe. The smiles and the relief. The dark days were over. It was a day for celebration. Instead of looking down a rifle barrel, war-weary veterans were looking into the face of hope. But all of this American joy, would only be a dream if it weren't for another day, not too distant in the past. A day that changed history and the world.
I didn't seem like I was so scared then, but I know I was. You just had a job to do and you went ahead and got after it, you know.
I just started to do a job and that's all I was wanting to do, and I was wanting to get out and get home.
If I had it to do over again, I would sure do it.
Echoes of Valor on Omaha Beach. As the English Channel surf pounds the coast of France at Normandy, an uneasy tranquility fills the air here. It's been 50 years, but not even spring, in all of its glory, can hide the scars of invasion. This is a land where time stands still, here in these coastal villages in Normandy, France. Centuries-old buildings like this one still in use here in 1994. It's an area that is teeming with vegetation and a lush, vine-covered history, a history that is both beautiful and tragic.
It was pretty deadly, because there was a lot of shooting going on.
Everybody was scared. If you weren't scared, you were dead.
Allied naval forces, supported by strong air forces, began landing Allied armies this morning on the northern coast of France.
We needed the Lord to watch over us so that we get back home.
It's a dirty shame that we had to lose so many. And man, when we went up, when I got back up to the outfit, it was bad.
Four soldiers, all from the same state, in the same outfit, with the same mission: storm Omaha Beach and destroy the enemy. J.W. Creighton from Clinton, Bill Bruner of Frederick, Thomas Wilkins of McLeod, and Joe Manning from Chickasha. All members of the 146th Combat Engineers, part of the 5,000 ship armada that invaded Normandy on June 6, 1944. Four men out of the 150,000 that made the landing to take Europe back from Hitler. The 146th main job was to blow up the obstacles the Germans had set on the beach to slow the invasion forces. They waded onto the beach with their explosives and brave bullets and artillery to do their duty. They had to work fast to survive.
On the beach there, we waded up to them. Holler far in the hole three times, pull that fuse, turn and walk 10 paces, and then run like hell.
But for every man there, the new world of Normandy is a world of private agony and chaos.
The black and white images of newsreels brought the story home back in 1944. And it seems these ghosts of the past never fade from the beach. It's a different world now.
I'd say the beach pretty well looks like it did.
But the soldiers who died here will never be forgotten by their comrades who survived.
Get through the work that they done, you know, it helped us, you know, to pull it on through. Although they didn't make it, they still didn't. They've done all they could do. It's kind of sad in a way, knowing them old boys was just getting started in life, you know.
So many years ago, these young lives ended here, unselfishly given in the midst of German gunfire and the call of honor.
It's a shame for all of us Americans that had to lose their lives, for a man that was just, just ruthless, really. And if this old world don't straighten up and start living right, well, we're all going to be in trouble again. We was on alert all the time. You never could tell when sniper or something, you know, to still be out.
A soldier's memory, deadly images of a war gone by.
Yeah, those old hedgerows and those concrete telephone posts, they look familiar.
Through the rolling countryside of France, today fades into yesterday.
We know that by thy grace and by the righteousness of our cause, our sons will triumph.
On beaches called Utah and Omaha, they come ashore.
Well, here it is.
I never would have thought I'd have come back, you know, really. It's a lot quieter right now.
It's easy for the bloody legend of Omaha Beach to get lost in the gentle surf and stillness of a May afternoon 50 years later.
Chances are we hit long here.
J.W. Creighton from Clinton was one of the first men to hit this beach on D-Day. These priceless photos taken by war photographer Robert Capa were the only pictures taken of the first wave of men to storm Normandy. J.W. Creighton is part of this black and white reality. These pictures were taken in the same sector J.W. hit. For all he knows, he could have been crouched right next to Capa when the shutter snapped, but J.W. would have never noticed. He had other things on his mind, like staying alive.
We was coming in pretty good. You could look around, see somebody fall. They were pouring their lead to us out. Hey, I could see them old bullets, that small arm fire. They were just peppering that beach, you know. They could just sit down there and shoot at us, you know, like ducks. They finally got to shoot some of them old 88s in there, and I tell you, they had a noise to them. If you'd ever hear one, you'd never forget it. We just lucky enough that didn't get hit. Sometimes wonder how we got through it without getting hit.
This walk down memory lane was a quiet one for J.W. No tears, no emotional outburst, just a silent respect.
I'll remember some of them that we lost, I know. That's something it's hard to forget about.
Armed with only a camera this time, J.W. takes on the deadly memories of June 6th, but ghosts are hard to capture on film.
See those kids running around down here on the beach? They're full of life, having fun. If we hadn't have done that, they probably wouldn't be down here doing it.
Even for the French of 1994, the D-Day story has passed from generation to generation. And to them, soldiers like J.W. Creighton are real-life heroes.
If American and British don't came, we are perhaps, we don't know where we are today. It's in our hearts. You understand what I mean?
It's not only in their hearts, it's in their homes as well. Everywhere you look around the Normandy countryside, the French are saying, "Thank you, America. We will never forget." 5 decades have softened the landscape of Omaha Beach, but the ugly reminders of war are still here.
There's a lot of cement. That thing, that old top was pretty thick.
A gun that once wreaked havoc on American soldiers is now silent, but still menacing. J.W. remembers what it was like to be on the other end of this pillbox gun.
It rings back that old whining sound that 88 shot at us, boy. I'll tell you, it would scare you if you ever heard it. You'd never forget that old, the sound that it made.
Sometimes reliving the past is not so easy, especially when you come face to face with the kind of memories left over from this beach 50 years ago.
He was shooting down there at me, I bet you. I think that's where I was.
Walking in the footsteps of history, retracing a path that is both proud and bloody, on a beach where the Stars and Stripes was something to die for.
Yeah, we did. We believed in it. Well, there's just that much American in us, I think. We believe in fighting for our country.
The first person I shot, that bothered me, just to think that I had killed and shot somebody that the Lord had put on this earth.
We was first on that beach, I'll guarantee you, we was first on that beach.
There wasn't no infantry in front of us.
The first thing that entered my mind was, why did I volunteer? That's just the way it happened. And when Major Baker asked for anybody want to volunteer to make the invasion in France, well, I said, yeah, let's go.
The dry plains of Oklahoma are a long way from the ocean waves of Omaha Beach. But for Joe Manning, Bill Bruner, and Thomas Wilkins, it's not hard to thumb their way back in time to a place that is burned in their memory forever.
You hope that you're one of the survivors. My main hope was, after the tide came in and we were sitting up behind the seawall, that I could get back to Chickasha and Oklahoma and that I'd be perfectly satisfied. And that's the way it happened, and that's why one of the reasons that I have no desire to go back over there. I still feel happy to be home.
A few miles down the road in Frederick, Bill Bruner lives life quietly now, but on that day 50 years ago, Private Bruner was doing what he had to do to stay alive.
The church was there, had a big steeple on it, and that's who was shooting, picking us off out there, the snipers, and the first chance I was one of the few, they got a bazooka and blowed that steeple off that church. And we put a stop to that real quick. You watch how you got up, you watch how you moved over, and how you didn't fool around and stand up and walk. Well, you've been over and run, and wishing you could run faster.
Bruner was just thankful to get the chance to run. He almost died in the choppy waters of the English Channel.
And when I went off the side, I stepped into a bomb crater and went over my head and like to drown it. A 60-pound pack on my back that it carried me down. And when I come up the second time, I hollered for help. And when I come up the third time, I stuck my rifle out and somebody grabbed a hold of him and pulled me out.
If I hadn't jumped sideways to help save that buddy and shove him that lifesaver, I wouldn't have been here because that bullet hit me right in the back. Got hit when I went back out there to help this buddy off the beach. Everybody tried to help each other. And that's why I got that Silver Star and Purple Heart. And that's what it looks like. And
Thomas Wilkins carries with him the rifle and the scars of D-Day. He was shot in the hip. Someone needed his help, and he didn't think about the bullet with his name on it. That moment has lasted a lifetime.
You don't ever forget it. Never forget it. Never gets off of my mind. You know, I always think about the war.
The bullet left Wilkins disabled, but it didn't wound his pride.
Serve my country. Could have died over there. That's the biggest part. I didn't shirk my job in the Army.
If you're not there and can see it, you can't just understand how a person's over in it, how he really feels.
He said, well, you didn't have it too bad. They wasn't there. People at home, people that thinks that the war ain't nothing, you know, young kids and stuff, they don't think much of it. Maybe when you get there, you know it's rough.
I'm highly respectful of the fact that they were willing to serve and were willing to make the invasion. We didn't have anybody try to beg off. We were under sniper fire and machine gun fire continuously.
They were young men with courage, 19 or 20, and believing themselves bulletproof. But those indestructible feelings were shattered on the beach as the reality of war rained down on them.
One shell hit to the right of Colonel Leslie. I was on his left, and Sergeant Robert Campbell was on Colonel Leslie's right, and that's the last that we ever saw of Sergeant Campbell. There was nothing that was ever found that could identify him, dog tags or anything.
Jesse Cleveland come by me running souped over, and I told him to get down on the ground. And he said, well, I'll be going when you're dead and gone. And that's the last I saw him.
They were a different breed, these Oklahomans who stormed Normandy. They wore the uniform of patriotism. Because in 1944, with the world at war, fighting for your country wasn't just an old-fashioned, outdated idea. They rallied around the flag, and to them, those who aren't willing to follow the charge don't deserve to live under the Stars and Stripes.
I think you should deport them. If they can't stand up for America, That guy, they ought not be here. They ought not have the right to freedom. They can't stand up for our flag. I know people that, that won't vote, won't salute the flag, stuff like that, and wouldn't go to war when I was a kid. And really, I don't think they got any right to have all the freedom that we got. If they won't stand up for this country, I ain't got no use for them.
That's the way we were taught. And there's a picture right up there that's happens to be my favorite picture. When I was very young, why, my father took that picture with me under the flag.
Why is that your favorite picture?
And I believe in the flag of the United States of America. And I resent the people that don't.
The ranks of the fallen, the American cemetery at Normandy. All of the markers here face west, toward America, toward home.
It's kind of sad in a way, knowing them old boys was just getting started in life, you know.
An Oklahoma soldier walks a lonely path through a graveyard of memories. Over 4,000 American families told the Army they wanted their son's final resting place to be here, in France, a foreign land they were willing to die for.
When they're shooting at us, you know, you see them old bullets hitting around you, you know, hitting the sand, the beach.
Soldiers like J.W. Creighton, who put their lives on the line.
I always said I didn't think there was my name on any of them, and it wasn't down here.
Plenty of names behind you, though.
Yeah. That's right. There's a bunch of them. I hit D-Day.
Is that right?
One of the first ones, yeah.
Where are you from?
Oklahoma. Yeah.
Where did you come in? Did you come in this
right way? Here on Omaha Beach.
You did?
Right here. On the landing, yeah. See, ours just like a suicide mission. Ours was to clear the beach.
Off,
we wasn't shooting at them or nothing. Our mission was to get rid of the obstacles, and all they had to do was shoot at us.
Oh,
and that's what they done.
Sure, yes. Proud to meet you.
Yes, I am too.
A D-Day vet is an honored guest here. From those visiting Americans who are old enough to remember, to the younger generation of French who are just now learning how soldiers like J.W. Creighton gave them back their country.
We thank him for the things he do, because they gave their life for France, and we were perhaps on with Germans, yes.
It's easy to see how some people could forget about what happened here. After all, it's been 50 years since soldiers like J.W. Creighton, Bill Bruner, and Joe Manning put their lives on the line and helped free Europe from the Nazi terror. But like some people will tell you, it's hard to know where to go if you don't know where you've been. And that might be the lesson of D-Day. Remember it. Freedom never comes at bargain prices. The cost is high. The payment was made here in blood, duty, and honor.
The wounds of D-Day are still visible at Omaha Beach, but the countryside has healed during the 50 years since the invasion. And the names of those who fought their last battle June 6, 1944 are now etched into the memory of those who lived to fight on, to see the victory and the peace that all began on one day of valor.
Oh, I believe we learned a lot, you know, all that killing going on, you know, at that time. That's something. It's hard to forget about.
If you could say anything to those guys there, if they were still alive, what would you tell them?
Oh, I did have to tell them to keep their head down.
Thank you.